We have had exactly 31 sessions before now. I'll correct this later. And today is for me to just quickly do a recap. In fact, putting the slides together, that's part of what caused the problem. I never thought it would take me 1 hour to put the slides together. So I don't know the magic I will do in taking you through the slides in 1 hour. But then I will try, okay? So let me just quickly, before I start the rush session, let me give you the slides ahead. So I'm giving us slides ahead now. I think we have a participant who is already starting financial modeling early. I can hear her voice or his voice in the background. It's nice. But we encourage others to hear it in the recording that it's not too, it's never too early. Start your work. So I've sent this the download of the slide link in the chat section, so you have that. All right, so the race begins right now. We've had 31 sessions before now, right? Session one, in fact, let me give you the link to the all the recordings so you can have that straight up. It's also in the link I sent us, just grab it right now. It's in the slide, but then again, it's not too much of a work to give. So I'm just going to immediately click here, get us that link. So you can always, anytime you are free or there's anyone that I'm mentioning that for you it's important, you can just selectively go to that one and rewatch that session. Okay? So we started. The first one was last year. I can't remember the day of the month and which month specifically, but I think it was around middle of last year when we started these weekly sessions. Okay. And the first one was a broad overview of financial modeling. So what financial modeling is about and the course. It's not the course. And a sample financial model. I think that was what we did. Okay. So after that, we went to how you build out the depreciation schedule, the equity schedule, valuation method. So it was, this one too was a bit like overloaded. I think some people's head were spinning by the time we were almost at the end, because it was a lot. So I learned from that one. I stopped trying to do too much in one session. And I started trying to pick maybe one or two max topics to go through. But if you are interested, you can see the agenda. You can see how many things that we try to cover in 1 hour, right? So, but then, you know, that was what we did. So we went through the depreciation schedule, the equity schedule, the valuation methods. And that was the session number two, okay? So if you're interested, you can just click on it. You can even play from your slides. You know, that's why I tried to give us the slides. And you can play it directly from the PDF and all. So. Then number three was, so at this point, we started getting different people. You know, we started trying to bring in other people, other experts to share their journey, because a lot of our participants, because at this point, most of the people who are joining the sessions were people who are taking our courses and people maybe from Udemy. So we have about over 40,000 people from Udemy. I'm surprised that I don't see many of them here. But then I understand, they say Udemy people buy courses or register, they don't even do the course. And I'm part of them. I have like maybe like 70 courses on Udemy. I think it's only two or three are finished. So it's understandable. But then the key thing was that people who are genuinely following, they had this problem of they are just at an impasse. You know, they are just at a session where they are learning. The problem is not that they are learning, but they don't see how to connect what they are learning with how they're going to apply it in their career. They don't see how to even shift career for those who are trying to shift their careers, you know, who are trying to align their careers. And that was why they were doing these trainings. So we decided to let us, I've talked about it, but then my own story is really unique. Not everybody can follow it. I don't have an accounting background originally. I was already in consulting, you know, not everybody can follow my own path. So we decided to get other speakers to talk just about their own journey. So we got the Mr. Charles Otogile has been a regular person on our session. So you probably will have enjoyed some of his recent sessions, even if it were not here on for this one, where he talked just about his journey, right? So then we got big prize from from Ghana. Let me let our other participants not feature too much in the, so let me go for, okay, so I've muted. I apologize for meeting them, but we have acknowledged their presence already. So Bernard is the guy in Ghana that is doing amazing things, you know. Whenever I go to Ghana, I try to link up with him, you know. My being a certified, our company becoming one of the approved financial modeling training providers is all because of him. You know, he was the one who showed us the way and all of that. But again, because I know how inspiring his story is, I also got him to talk about how he got on his own journey, you know, and his own story, his own journey is completely different from mine. He started from the banking space. I'm not even sure this was what he was doing when he was working in the bank, right? So there's so many people like that who, even when you are along the line, you are working in a company where what they are doing is along the line of what you can apply financial modeling in, or, well, we are doing financial modeling, let's talk about financial modeling in. But then you find out that you are not in that role, and it becomes frustrating, and you just can't see how they will move you from your role to that role, right? So anyway, his own story too, his own journey is a very inspiring one, you know. So I would say you should watch it, you know, if you think you have that kind of a background. Let me tell you about the kind of background that Charles had. So for Charles, his own journey is slightly, there are some similarities. For him, he started working as a regular staff in a company, and you know as it is now, you join a company based on what you read and, you know, something. And then finally, because of your flair for data analysis and how well you are able to do things and save company time and automate reports and all, so his career was beginning to shift him towards analytics, right? And then he was working sometimes in some finance roles, and then he got to work in some companies that I don't want to talk for him. I want you to watch the sessions, but then there is one company he worked with that they were raising. They had to raise money from international buyers, like a private equity was funding them. And, you know, that was like very eye-opening. They were in deals running into millions of dollars that, you know, the things they were doing were things that even some banks did not have staff or capacity to do, you know. And so that was what set him, you know, steadfastly in this financial modeling space. And you will learn a lot from his journey. It was very, very open. He shared how everything was for him at the start and how he decided to also go into consulting and all. So if you want to go into consulting too, you can pick from him. So then we got Abraham Durocha. Some of you might know Finance Professional Nigeria. He's the one who started it. Lekki Concession Company, that was where he put to use many of the skills that many of us are trying to see and apply. And so he has both the hands-on experience and also the mentoring kind of platform. He has created platforms that help people to get into the investment banking space. He has a deep connection in that space. And so his journey too was really, his session was very, very eye-opening, different from every other person's session. You know, was showing us how, what it is employers are looking for, you know, and was showing us the gaps that if you, what they are expecting and how you can plug in those gaps. And, you know, I don't want to repeat everything because, you know, like I said, we're going to 32, 31, I'm on number five. Okay, so you can, this is just to help you understand the different sessions. So you'll be able to mark the ones that are important to you and you can go and selectively watch them, okay? So we, moving on from that, was now a session that I handled, which was like, what is even financial modeling, right? More like back to basics. What is actually financial modeling? Then taking us through a sample model. So this one was also a bit loaded because I had to take time to explain as if everybody in my audience are open to knowing what financial modeling is. They are putting aside whatever they know and saying, let me even hear, you know, from someone else explain what it is that financial modeling is about, the relevance, the importance, and where it's useful. Then we took a company and looked at the financial model. So if you think this will be useful for you, then go watch it. Okay, so I move on to the one after that, which is, we now talked about a software as a service company, SaaS. So a software as a service company is completely different. Think about Netflix. Think about, so this one you're looking at is one of the software that we use. I think this is, okay, no, we don't use, but this is Salesforce. Salesforce is one of the companies, is one of the oldest companies in SaaS. When the founder started it around year 2000, I think they were the only one in that category. Everybody else were building software that they sell. They said they were going to do is use a subscription model that you will subscribe online, you know, and you'll be getting access to the product as a cloud service. It was really novel. Nobody really gave them that benefit of doubt that they will grow as big as they grew. You know, even I read some of the insider stories. They were, the founder is, he says, what's this guy's name? Steve Jobs was one of his mentors at for a long time. So when they wanted to start the company, I think Steve Jobs had registered, I picked the name they wanted to use. I can't remember the name of the, but anyway, the story was very interesting. Okay, I've mixed some things up. But the key thing is that for software as a service company, right, all of the basics, all of the dynamics are radically different when you start using a bottom-up approach. You know, they don't have the typical cost of goods sold. They have cost of revenue, which is another explanation in itself. The way you compute it, I work remotely for a private equity firm. Sometimes I feel guilty that maybe I'm overflogging it because really I don't work that much anymore for them as such, but they always come back to me once in a while for some things regarding the companies they are trying to invest in. And one of the most recent ones was regarding a startup, a software as a service company that is into the insurtech, like they call it, where you're using, you know, as we know, we have fintech. Also in the insurance space, it's like insurtech. So that's what the company does, where you have a platform, you can buy insurance, you can, everything you want to do on the platform. You don't have to physically engage somebody, and you are able to make claims. You're able to see details of everything you want in that insurance space. They connect you to different insurance. They have aggregated providers, insurance firms across Francophone West Africa. I think that was their focus. So the key thing was they wanted to invest in the company, but then they cannot use the typical model that you've been using for manufacturing companies, right? This one, everything is different when you look about the economics, the unit economics of a software as a service company. They don't have the kind of expenses or capex that a traditional company will have. So how then do you factor in their own uniqueness? So there's what we call a software as a service financial model. You know, so in this webinar, I was really, really very generous. I shared templates that now you cannot even get without paying for, like we now sell them. You know, I gave a lot of free resources. I was so granular in explaining it. So if you think that you are in that kind of space where the guys you'll be doing models for are into fintech or they are into internet-based companies where they are not going to be having capex, they are not going to be building factories, they're not going to be buying raw materials to produce things. They are just going to be having to convert codes into solutions and products and selling and all of that. Then you're going to benefit from this session. Okay, so I move on to the one after that. So the one after that was on. So remember I said I took learnings. I learned from the original sessions that instead of me putting too many content, let me just pick one or two things. So this one, I singled out the scenarios again, and I started explaining, you know, scenario building, how you go about building scenarios into your financial model. And so that was what we covered here. We took an entire 1 hour to do it. I answered questions. I explained why you want to have different scenarios, and then how you can capture different people's ideas and capture different optimist, you know, best case, worst case. And then people ask questions, and I think this one was a bit more relaxed. It wasn't looking rushed, and anybody who went through that session should be able to build scenarios into any kind of model, not even just financial models. Okay, so by the way, I hope you hear me loud and clear. If you do not hear me, let me know. You can always also use the chat too. Let me just pop up the chat too, so that I will be seeing whatever anybody is writing there. All right, so thanks for those who just joined. Let me just repost right now before we go too far the slides, so that we know that I've given us the slides ahead, so that everything that I'm doing, if you are using a computer, you can even open the slides, you know, and be able to access the links immediately. So if there's anything I mentioned that you feel this one is important to you, you just open this the video. You will not tell it to play, you keep it so that after the session you can go and watch it. So this is also, I've posted also the link to the entire recordings of the past sessions. All right, so continuing. So after that, we had another session which I was in charge of, and then I decided to do something interesting. How do you build the general ledger trial balance? And it was a bit rushed, I must confess, but then I made sure that I covered the concept that no one who was in this session will be confused about how to go from scratch to building a general ledger and a trial balance, right? So, and I think I also shared templates. Yeah, I shared the templates that we used. We walked through things from as if you are doing for a company that was not keeping any proper record, and they were just giving you bank statements and receipts, paper receipts, and invoices, and you have from there, you have to build out their trial balance and all. How will you go about it? Again, I said for big companies, you can get away with not knowing this because they already have in place systems and people who are paid, that is their job to be posting. In fact, they even separate people who pay, who post for things that are like income to the company, so receivables and all of that. So you see somebody whose job role is related to receivables, another person is related to payables, you know. So that's how much they have made sure that it's easy for the data and the general ledger to build itself, because they are using all those tools that automatically, you know, build all those things, right? But then when you understand these things, it helps you to even see things in a bit more interesting way. So you're able to see, okay, you know what, if you're ever going to be needing to do something for someone whose business is not structured, or even if the system was wrongly set up, you will not be throwing tantrum. You know, when you get a consultant and the consultant is not seeing what he's expecting and what he needs to do to clean your work is beyond what he can do, you know, he starts throwing tantrum. So how do you call it? Like, he starts just complaining and saying, you know, this is not what I expected. But if the guy can fix it, well, it will just be like, wow, you guys' work is really messed up. Okay, you know what? Maybe I'll just help you and fix it, or maybe I'll add more to my charges. But it's not going to be a big bone of contention. So that was why I decided, even if you work in a company that all is automated, it makes sense to still be aware. But much more if you want to work or consult bros or sister, you have to know this one. Otherwise, you will be shortchanging yourself. There are so many companies, even companies you think that are big, that they are not following all of this, and you will have to start from paper trail. Okay, so then we did, after that, I was the one who also anchored this one. What about the cash flow statement? So how do you extract, because I noticed that in some of the trainings I do, when I ask for people's expectations, they say income statement is straightforward. Balance sheet is tricky, but they always still end up getting it right. They say it's the balance, it's the cash flow that gives them the most trouble. So I decided to talk about, you know, what are all those pain points that you understand how to get out the cash flow, and then you will find out that those pain points automatically just disappear. Because most of the time, what we are doing is we are using a manual approach that makes us to be frustrated. Imagine that I want to, what can I give as an example? Imagine you want to know the revenue that a company made, and you decided that you, knowing the revenue, you want to go and download the bank statement, and the company has like four different bank statements, and this company also has an ERP, they have a financial system. But you said, no, don't worry. I'm going to use the bank statement. Don't give me your phone. And they have people who are posting revenue there, right? You see, you're just going to be suffering unnecessarily, right? But then if you just take use of the financial system they have, you'll find out that maybe your sufferings will be less because you will just be working with what has already been well computed. The same thing today, there's a framework that allows you to extract the cash flow from the balance sheet and income statement. And as long as your balance sheet is correct, right, you'll find out that the cash flow will come out exact. In fact, it will become the benchmark that you will use to judge whether there is mago-mago in the account statement. You know, there can be sometimes the records are missing in the bank statement. Yeah? You download bank statement. Unfortunately, the transaction that was supposed to come with this year, the thing did not clear very well. The transaction trail is showing for next year. What should have come December 31 is now showing January 1st. You know, all those things are part of the problem you face. But when you work with the framework, you'll find out that that one even becomes the benchmark that you use to understand, judge the other ones that people will be using. So we covered that. I'm just emphasizing that it can be important for some of us who you have had pain points with cash flow statement. Okay, so, and then we went to, so this one was really interesting because that at this period, I was really confused about, you know, what can I do that would be really, really interesting? So I thought about it. So I used to handle a stock analysis trading for one company. And I found out that people used to be a lot more enthusiastic about it. You know, they're like, oh, awesome. I'm going to, what these things you are explaining, I'm going to go from listening to all what you are saying and applying the information. And I said, wow, if these people who are not even financially inclined or originally do not have any interest in financial modeling and all of that, they consider these things to be very high value and practical. Let me even just talk about it on our own session. How do you build a proper investment portfolio? Why do you even go about having an investment? So this was more on a personal level. So this is not something for your company or for you doing for a corporate entity. It's now for you as a person, you know, with all this your accounting knowledge and finance knowledge, what are the practical things you need to be aware of? How do you practically, what tools are there that you can leverage? What approach should you take to building your own personal investment portfolio? And I was all generous in even showing my own portfolio. So I have tools that are built to help you to do your portfolio allocation, monitor it, track variances, rebalance your portfolio, then also keep track of your, if you have US equities holdings, if you have Nigerian stocks, it will be automatically tracking your profit, your returns, your portfolio volatility automatically by itself. You don't have to be the one going there and be updating the price of these things you bought. And so I showed people all of that and people were like, wow, you know, this is amazing. Someone was like, he didn't even know all these tools existed. And he's been trying to do them by himself. That he was really, he was very grateful that I'm letting him aware that there are already existing tools you can use. You know, sometimes people are trying to look for information on the Nigerian financial market and they just get frustrated. They say they can't find. Sometimes it's not that it's not there. It's just that you are not just aware. And sometimes when you search on Google is a, how do I say it? It's the way you ask sometimes is more important than what you ask. You know, sometimes I deliberately type something in a very foolish way so that I will get the answer that I need from Google. It's not a human being, it's a computer that is programmed. Nah? So anyway, that's what this one covered. In case you're interested, then now you know. So then on number 12, we talked about how do you even break into the financial modeling consulting world? So I used myself as an example. I do not have an accounting background originally, so maybe now I can say I have. But at the start, I didn't have. I didn't even have certifications. It wasn't like I have ACCA or most of the certifications I got, not even all the most, because there was one I got before I started, actually Bloomberg one. But most of the certifications I got were after I had started. So I'm more like, it's more like a case of if I can do it, most likely you can even do it better than I have done it, right? So I was here explaining the pattern I took, I don't know if some people also commented and shared their own part, how they got here, but there were some questions that I also answered. So if you're interested in consulting and you think that there are some ideas or things, learnings you can pick from this one, then awesome, you know, go watch it, you know. So I shared my own journey and practical learnings and how you can instill confidence, you know, how you can, and what are the typical areas of concern when you are doing stuff for people. It's only, I think, billing that I didn't mention, how you will bill people. Okay, so then this one was another very interesting session. So a lot of times, especially if you work in a company, you'll find out that sometimes you need to create multiple views. So take, for instance, budget. You know, when you are doing budget, most of the time, it's like top down. You do budget, first of all, like for the whole year. So it's like, this is what we are budgeting, you know, across the different cost centers, you know, across the different subsidiaries for the whole year. And then it starts becoming a case of, how do we break this budget down to like a monthly stuff for different departments, cost centers, and what have you. So I showed us here how you can, without stressing yourself, well, you stress yourself small, but not as much as if you didn't know this approach, how you can create multiple views. So instead of you having one Excel that will be for yearly budgets, and then another Excel that will be for the quarterly or breakdown, then another Excel still for the monthly breakdown. And anytime there's a change, you will have to go and update it in all of those different files. No, that's too much stress, huh? Don't go and grow gray hairs. That's why sometimes when you see some people who have gray hairs in their work, the gray hair might not just be all of age. It's because sometimes the work is stressful, and if it's a data analysis work, it might be because they themselves are taking the hard way to some of what they are doing. So there is always an easy way to most of what we do. And then I decided to focus on this one particularly and show us how we can create multiple views. So you will just create the monthly. And from the monthly, you can easily extract out quarterly and easily extract out year. So anybody who wants to see year, bim, you click on the year view, and that's what you will see. You will see, you know, year. And I even gave an example of a UK company. They're a private capital firm. They are into real estate in Africa. They have operations in about 5 countries in Africa. And then I was doing their financial statement analysis, though it was for internal expansion, right? And then, yes, sir.
Yeah. Please, can you also, I've seen the link. Can you also share with us all the templates that were used in all these recaps, including this one, budgeting thing? You know, some were, may have been upset in some, though I was present for quite some. So like this, all these templates, assistive templates that were used, the completed thing. I don't know if you can kindly share all of them with us now.
Great. So let me even go to this one that I'm talking about. Where is it? So can you see my screen, Sam?
Yes, sir.
Can you see that there is a place that says download the practice file? I've highlighted this part. So what I've done, I might have missed some, but I think at one time I tried to do it because people too ask that I missed the session, I was not there. Maybe I shared the material during the session, but me that was not there, that I'm watching, how will I get it? So I now started adding it in the video description. So if you look at this now, you will see that I've already put the link. Though okay. I can still paste it now, but in case, just generally for everybody, if your own, what you are interested in is even a different video, once you just go there, you will just see the practice file. So I try to do that. Okay. So thank you. It's even very good. So that way, anybody who has similar concern will know that that's a quick way to get the material. Thank you, sir.
So, thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. So I... So the third 14 was now on valuation. So what are the different valuation methods, right? But now this one, a bit more to the academic side, kind of, but still, if you are going to be doing valuation or if you're going to be interviewing for some jobs that involve creating financial models and doing valuation, they want you to be aware of this, because the reality is something that you should be able to align what you know technically to. If you're not able to draw the connection between what happens in real life with all of these technical things we learn, the things you do when you are doing your ICANN exams, when you are doing your ACCA, and to you, they are just looking like technical and technical, and you never really try to connect them to what happens in the real world, you find out that missing link can be very dangerous, you know. So here I decided to talk about the different valuation methods and what is peculiar to them and why do we use some of them. The most popular one is the CAPM, Capital Asset Pricing Model. It's the simplest, right? Also, is the one that has kind of like the most problem. But you know what? In most of the valuations in the DCF and a lot of the valuations we do is what we use, even though the problems, they are obvious. You know, nobody disagrees about the problem. But then we cannot agree. There's all of the both researchers and people who are in the at the forefront of expanding the industry knowledge around all these things. Nobody has ever agreed on a replacement that can fully function, that everybody will have a consensus on, as everybody already has a consensus on CAPM and its drawbacks. So then I explained that there is APT, arbitrage pricing theory, which everybody agrees is better, but then nobody knows how to correctly implement it in a uniform way. How do I explain? Imagine I want to explain to you how to okay, let me use this that is coming to my mind. I want to explain to you how to boil egg, right? And I say, okay, boiling egg involves five steps. Step number one, get a kettle or a pot. Step number two, pour water that will reach, okay, pour 1 liter of water in a kettle or pot of a radius of 10 centimeter, right? And if it's whatever if the centimeter of the radius is more, double, you know, expand the amount of water you pour. So something that is very, very straightforward and technically explained. Step number three, you know, put the eggs. The eggs must not be more than what can, you know, touch the bottom of the kettle, so that one egg is not standing on top of another egg. Step number four, you know, put everything on heat of about, you know, maybe on high heat. If you're using gas cooker, on high heat, if you're using it on high heat anyway, and boil for 10 minutes. Very clear. Anybody can follow it and the outcome will be the same, right? But think about, you want to say how to prepare white soup. I tell you, if you write it the way you do it, another person does it, you will never get the very same way you have done it. The outcome will always still be different, because there are so many subtleties, you know, that there's no way you will write it that everybody will do it and we come to exactly the same answer that you have. You know, so that's the same thing that you can say about CAPM and APT. CAPM can be likened to that boiling egg. Straightforward, that if I explain how I did it, you can follow my steps and get the same answer. But APT, if I explain how I did it, like, and I'm so very, very elaborate about my explanation, you will still never get the same outcome that I get. So that's why people naturally go for the CAPM. It's easy to explain, everybody can have a consensus. You do what I said I did and you get the answer. APT, you can never get what I get, you know. So That's a very rough way of saying it. So that's why CAPM is popular. And then in reality, things are a lot more muddy. So depending on the kind of assets you are valuing, people have different common ways of coming to the. If you are valuing real estate, you find out that people we do rather do a per square meter kind of pricing rather than doing CAPM or APT, you know. And if you are valuing even startups, they start doing per active user or as a ratio, valuation multiple that is ratio of maybe sales or ratio of some kind of ratio of some metric. So reality is a lot, you know, like they say, reality is stranger than fiction. So that's just the point I want to point out. So I pointed that out here. We try to align the technical with reality. So a lot of people, I even remember somebody saying nobody has ever explained CAPM that way for him, that, you know, now everything is just clicking in his head that, oh, okay, all these things that he's been doing in exams, this is the real, this is the way they interface with reality. So I was really happy. That's why I even remember it, because I remember the person mentioning that. So then we talked about financial statements here. So how do you even read a financial statement? What are the lines items there? What do they mean? And what is the common things that you will see across different industries? And then some other things that are not, that are kind of unique. You know, what's biological assets? Is it a biological weapon? Some industries have it. If you get the financial statements of flour mills, you get the financial statements of Okomu, you will see biological assets there. So every industry has some nuances. So I try to explain all of that. So that's one. Then 16 was on personal finance and personal investment. So because I noticed people really like that one I did about investment. So I decided to, okay, let's even talk about, you know, the entire framework of personal finance and personal investment. So this one too was something that again was different. I can't remember anything special about it too, but I know that it was really different from most of the other sessions that involved you applying it on your job. This was much more applying it on your own life, okay, and giving an example of what I do, what I treat them, tools I have built. Because to be sincere, me, I started from personal finance before even going to corporate finance. I was at a point I was having almost a celebrity status. That if you search anything personal finance in Nigeria, I was coming up. Even you see me before you see this other lady that is now an ambassador, Nimi Akinkugbe. So that was how that point too. I was really popular online. I used to get emails almost every couple of days. Then I write a blog post on Bella Naija on personal finance. So I try to still carry over some of those useful information into here. So if you are interested in personal finance, you might want to watch it. Maybe you might get one or two things that, you know, you might find applicable or useful. Then this was a guest session by a CFO forgotten the company name again. I hope he's not here. He's going to be annoyed. I've forgotten his company name. But he's a CFO in one of the companies in the healthcare industry, HMO-related industry. And so he decided to take us through financial plans as a component of a bankable business plan. So it was also interesting. I think Mr. Bolade even asked a question during his session, you know. So it was interactive too. So if you are thinking of going through it, then great, you know. So I, again now, this was me talking about finance for non-finance managers. So I was trying to say, okay, all these things we've been doing that has always been like for people who already even are in the finance space. What about people who they are not in the finance space? I've seen cases of people who they are getting promoted and they are now like CIO, Chief Information Officer, or CTO, or Head of Marketing. And at that stage, you need to start aligning with the financial plans of the company. You need to understand even the financial statement. There was a lady, I think I should even call her. There was a lady who, she told us that the real reason she's a lawyer, she said the reason is because she has to sign off on this financial statement. She's a company secretary. So she needs to have a thorough understanding. She has some knowledge, but then she feels like most of this knowledge are things she got on her own. She wants a proper training so that she will not, you know, they say you don't know what you don't know. So she don't want, she doesn't want to be blindsided. She doesn't want to have any blind spots when you're signing on financial statements of company. And you can't give an excuse that, oh, sorry, I'm the company secretary. I'm not an accountant. So, you know, anything I sign on, you cannot excuse me from any responsibility. No, I think she was the motivation for this session. So I decided that maybe there are other people too in our audience who this will be useful for them. So what are the things you need to know? I can't cover everything in 1 hour, but at least I first show you what are all the things you need to know. So you will know where you have gaps and what you know already. And if you want to do a self-study, you will know how you go about identifying what you want to learn. And I think I even shared some resources, books that are free, that you can leverage. So it's not until you come and do our paid training, you know, before you will know it. If you come and do our paid training, we'll thank you. But then again, that's not the only way. So that was what we covered in here. So if you're in that category, or if you know someone in that category, you can refer them to this. Then after that, we went into opening the year. You know, so this was a guest session. We had a very popular person. I've known him for a long time, Gospel Obele. He's the CEO of Streetnomics. He's in fact, if you watch Chinese TV, you will have seen him numerous times. He's always doing things on macroeconomics and all of outlook and giving comments on government policies as it affects economy and all of that on Chinese TV, on some other TV, I think Arise. Then he runs things for companies too. So he has done consulting for Ford NGO where they sponsor, and they don't talk for a lot of companies, even in the FMCG, helping them to understand the market strategy and all of that. So he was explained to us, you know, how to go into the new year, what are the things you should be aware of, you know, the outlook for 2021. So a lot of people found it really interesting. I learned a lot of things too, because it showed the pattern of our economy, the GDP pattern, inflation pattern. He took all those macroeconomic figures and he helped us to see how they have on the ground effect on our livelihoods. And then what you should do as an individual, what you should do as a company, you know, to be able to take advantage of things that you can take advantage of and insulate yourself from things that could cause you problems. So it was a very insightful one. And then we went to personal loan and loan calculation. And this was just on loan schedule. How do you calculate loan repayment plan and all of that? And when you take loans, you know, how do you even compare different loans and do your own calculation yourself and see whether some people are trying to, you know, rip you off, you know, where they will tell you that the loan is 1%, but then another person is telling you that his own loan, you know, let me rephrase, their own loan is 2%. Another person is telling you their own loan is 18% per year. Which one is better? Most people don't know. They think 2% is better. No, you have to do apple to apple comparison, you know. So what are the things you watch for? How do you do that on the personal loan side, on business loans that are structured like personal loans too? If you take some SME loans, they are structured like that. Then even on the corporate loans too, how do you also easily build out the schedule? So that was what we did here. And then after, we had another session by another expert, Nome, who works with Money Africa. You must have heard of Money Africa. And so he told us about where to invest in year 2021. And again, he took a very practical approach that I think you will find very, very useful. And so that was what we did here. If you're interested, you can go watch that session. And then this one, somebody even is Mr. Ladi in this call. So he mentioned, I think, 2 weeks ago. Right. So here I showed us how to create a speedometer, you know, a speedometer in Excel, create waterfall chart, those things that people like to be able to do or they like when they see it in other people's report, but they are at a loss as to how to create it in their own. So I did all of these and people were really happy with it. I think I had a good number that my head was swelling too. I'm like, hey, a lot of people joined today's session. People are just adding people to the session. So if you're interested in this, then please go watch it. Then what about career opportunities for financial modelers? So what are the career opportunities? So here I decided to talk about what are the different career opportunities for people who have financial modeling knowledge. So I think we talked about in the proper corporate world where you could work, in the consulting space, how you could also fit into into any aspect of those areas. So we talked about different opportunities that are there and how you can prepare yourself for those opportunities and plug into those opportunities. And this one, we talked about, so remember, I've been mentioning it, so I think I've been mentioning it again today. So I'm doing a master's in financial engineering. I'm wrapping up. I'm on my projects currently. In fact, my heart is beating because my deadline for submission for a part of our project is in phases. One phase comes due this week. I've not even touched it. My group members will be angry. But anyway, I decided to do, because not so many people are aware of all of this. So what is even a financial engineering, master's in financial engineering? You know, what do you need to be aware of? And what has been my own experience in the one I'm doing? What's the experience generally across all the programs? You know, what are the subtle differences that exist between programs? What kind of opportunities does it open up for you? What requirements do they ask? You know, so I talked about everything, and some people found it really useful and eye-opening. And so I'll move on. Then we had a guest session by Charles, where he talked about the building blocks in financial modeling. So he talked about how you can create schedules out of from scratch. So he did about depreciation, he did about many different things. So this is a very interesting one that you should watch. So he talked about those things you need to have as foundational, as primary skills in your building tool set. Okay, so, and then we had one of the biggest women in the, not even just woman, one of the biggest personalities in the financial modeling space, Danielle Steyn-Fairhurst. So she joined us from Australia, she presented to us, and unfortunately the timing, because for her, I think I don't know, is it 10 hours ahead of us? It's a very funny time difference. It was as if by the time we are middle of the day, they are already tomorrow. So the timing was really very problematic, that it had to come at like church time, like was it 10 o'clock or 9 o'clock Nigerian time. But anyway, people joined and people watched again the recording. And so it was interesting. She talked about the different scenario creation ones, Monte Carlo, manual, automated scenario, advice. Then she talked about her experience too. Oh, I forgot to even mention, everybody, every guest session, people are always talking about their experience. The CFO, Mr. Samuel, that talked about the banking, but he talked about, and his own experience was very inspiring. You know, he used to work in insurance, and you know, how he got his job, how he became a CFO, it was not what he was looking out for. In fact, it wasn't even, his mind was not on the opportunity that made him, you know, it was a job I think KPMG put up. Somebody told him to just apply. He was looking for something else. So everybody that we get, they always talk about their experience. And I tell you, it has always been a very, very insightful one. What happened to my recording? It's voila. It's like my computer has gone. Okay, sorry. I hope I've not fried my hard drive. I mean my CPU. I've put the thing on 100%, so the thing has been very hot. I think it has gone off. No problem. I'm going to switch my presentation to another one. So let me just open the slide. Thank God I've given us the link. So let me just download the link myself and open from here and then share my screen. I use two PCs at once, but that one is my work PC. I'm going to cry if it's damaged though. Sometimes that's why they say it's not, you should be careful when you do alter your system configuration. So I altered mine to always be working at 100% CPU. Now it's very hot. I'm touching it. It's super hot. And I think it has just gone off by itself. All right, so I've downloaded now. I'm going to share screen from here. The disadvantage is I might not be able to see your chat message instantly. So maybe if you ask me any question, it will be after that I'm going to now see your message and answer. But then at least I have a backup. Okay, so we were here, scenario analysis. Okay, yeah, so we were here. Oh, the PDF is not clickable. Okay, sorry. All right. But I gave us the original link also here. So in case if your own PDF 2 is not clickable, and it might be that is this way I'm opening it that is not clickable, you can always go here. Okay. So in case if you are experiencing similar non-click from your PDF. Then after that, we did a financial statements model versus project finance model. So this one, two people said was really eye opening. What's the difference between a financial statements, the corporate finance model, and the project finance model? So at this point, I think I was just wrapping up a project finance model stuff for an oil and gas company. So I just felt, well, maybe I should just talk about the differences, because some people do not know that project finance is completely like another kettle of fish in itself. So I talked about what is peculiar to it, how it is always structured differently. You know, it has a waterfall, cash flow waterfall kind of approach, and then it doesn't have a traditional balance sheet and then cash flow statement, and then you know they have some specific ratios, like even there's debt sculpting, debt service coverage ratio, project life coverage ratio, loan life coverage ratio. So we talked about all the things that were unique to project finance, and some people are like, wow. And then we give examples how the Lekki, that toll gate in Lekki is actually project finance, you know, and then how, because it's being closed right now, some issues will probably be happening, you know, as for them meeting up with their debt expectation and their plans as it is in the project finance model. And that's why they are trying to reopen it, you know, even if we were clamoring for the fact that some people's lives were lost there, it is an insult on their lives to reopen it. But then you don't know that there are so many other things be, you know, outside of all of that. But anyway, we try to link it back to reality. Then we had this mastering and automating cash sweep. So I talked about how you do cash sweep. I broke it really, really down, and I shared it and a template. So people were really like, wow, you know, this thing is not as complex as some people make it to be. It's really easy, because all what you are doing is you're understanding that cash sweep is, if there's enough money left, we want to pay back our debt faster. So there are some rules. You cannot pay more than what you have outstanding in your loan, then you cannot deploy more than what you have as extra, and then how does that now impact your remaining principal outstanding and impact your interest expense and the time it takes you to finish paying? And you find out that, you know, when you start writing all these things, they are not difficult to just, it's when you try to write everything together in one giant formula, that's where the whole thing begins to break our head, and you're like, ah, this thing is too difficult. But the moment you start breaking it down into its normal step by step, you find out it's very easy. So we did that, and some people are like, wow, you know, this thing is not as difficult as they've always been looking at it. Then we went to understanding and computing financial ratios. I think this is what we did then 3 or 2 weeks ago. And then, you know, financial ratios, we talked about liquidity ratios, we talked about asset management ratios, so profitability ratios also. And then this one was another guest session. So we had Victor Ogundele, he's a trainer, he works with the Brown, he has done a lot of financial models, he's trained over 1,000 people on financial modeling, he's certified FMVA, yeah, I think he also has AFM. So he too shared from his experience, and more importantly, shared the story, which was also very unique. You know, how it was by mistake he got into this space, and how when he saw the opportunity, he took it by the bull. You know, when other people would be looking for people to give them a chance, he rather created his own chance. You know, he locked himself up for 1 year and was just dedicatedly building financial models, learning and getting projects and forcing people to give him projects and collecting ridiculously low money just so that they can become perfect, you know, and all. So I found it really instructive for people who keep thinking, how do I build up my skill? You know, nobody's giving me a chance. Most of us, nobody gave us a chance. We had to take the chance or create our chance. So his own was really great. You know, he did a lot more than even me I did. So then we had another guest session. This was last week by Charles, and it was on auditing formulas in financial model, and it was very eye-opening. So how do you audit your formulas? What are the tools Excel has put in place for you to even be able to track errors? You know, how do you go into those things, and what are the keyboard shortcuts that allow you to see where something is coming from? So I even learned from here. You know, I didn't know the control shift brackets. I knew the control brackets, but then I was like, oh, okay, control shift bracket too. Was really awesome. So you will learn from that if you're interested. So that's the end, actually. So any questions? I think we are done with the old timing too. Let me just go back to my screen. So any questions at this juncture before we wrap up? Right, so if there are no questions, that means I'm allowed to end the session then. Because actually, I still have to finish the slides for the Excel session, and I'm already afraid. You know, even this one took me that long, and that one I've not even started the slides. So, but thank you for joining. And again, if no questions, then thank you. Let me just repost the links for both the slides and the slides and the video recording of the past sessions. So thank you very, very much.
Hello, Mr. Mayor. Hello, Mr.
Yes, sir.
Please, yes, sir. Help us cross-check again so that if there is any video that doesn't have the associated robust template, you can, or is it not even better to put all templates in one place, sir? So that we just know that all these are associated as their templates for all the recapped something, sir.
Yeah, I don't know how easy that will be able to. But I think it's easier for me to go and check and see which one does not have and put.
Okay, sir. Because the templates go a long way, sir. Yeah. And this financial engineering topic too, if you can still bring it back together with financial engineering template and training, maybe for next week.
Mr. Michael.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
I know I've missed a lot of the classes.
But this I was not there last week.
My
chair session too. I was saying hi today. I was thinking you were there from the beginning.
I was there today. I started from the beginning. I'm having a challenge. Some of the times when you send the links, I don't get it. I don't know why. I got the one in the WhatsApp, but when you are sending the videos on the class, this
on the teams, on the teams, Abby.
Yes, I don't.
What about the one I sent today? Did you see them? The one I
saw the one. No, I've not seen those ones.
Wow.
Yeah, I think I'm having problem with my team stuff.
Okay, I'll try and see what I will do. Thank God I even have your personal contacts.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thanks for the feedback.
It was awesome. Wonderful.
Hey, thanks, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you, everybody.